I think it's worth starting by saying, from a national perspective, just looking at statistics, Brighton has done well in transport terms. When I say well, it manages transport comparatively better. A queue size of what it's like back, if it's well here, what's it like elsewhere? But I think that the key point to say is that it's got some successes. It's got a couple of good bus companies. I think they're recognised to be among the best in the country, innovative ones, Lemon, and also Brighton Home Buses, which regularly wins awards for being one of the country's best bus companies. And the national surveys done show that bus users in Brighton are generally very satisfied with it. It's got high levels of walking and relatively low levels of car use and car ownership compared with particularly the rest of the South East. But I suppose the point I wanted to make is that this isn't something it can stand still on, because I think what Brighton, in common with other local authorities, countries as a whole perhaps, is facing is a new world. And there are new trends in transport, there are new challenges, and there are some new opportunities.
Thank you very much, and thank you very much everyone for coming this evening. I think it's important to remember and to think back, you know, for those of us that may have very long memories, I don't claim that myself, and actually recognise the benefits and the achievements that we have got in terms of the city's transport and the way that the city has adapted. Because we live in a city that's trapped between the sea and the downs, that has, you know, sort of both give a massive benefit to those living in the city, but at the same time are a massive constraint on how the city's developed. We also live in a city where the majority of the roads were designed for horse and car, not cars and lorries, you know, sort of many of which predate even bicycles, but not walking, luckily. You know, and we only need to look around the city and we can see that, you know, mews where originally there were stables were converted into garages and now have been converted into luxury homes. And things have moved and have progressed over that time, but we're facing the challenge that's far bigger, and that challenge has been outlined by other people here on the panel, is around climate change and is about needing to adapt far more radical proposals for how we address the needs of transport. And that really needs one single mindset change that can enable that. We need to stop thinking about moving vehicles. We need to start thinking about moving people.
The policies that we are proposing would be, in terms of the bus services, we want to support the local buses, the Brighton and Hove buses, who have their pledge to going forward to a emissions neutral bus fleet, to support them with electrification of the city and help them work with them to make an electric, to move forward into the electric fleet. I know they're working well in developing the hybrid fleet, but they're and then investigating moving forward into electric fleet, and also providing the infrastructure for electric cars to be welcome in the city as well. Next thing I want to touch on is the cycle network. We have some cycle network in the city at the moment, but we want to see that improved and expanded to make the city a really cycle-friendly place, and to support the choice to cycle safely through our city, and reduce the need for short car journeys, which is important for reducing air pollution and important in terms of individual and public health. And then the third policy I'll touch on is aimed at reducing congestion in the city and air pollution in the city, which is investigating the development of a park and ride system to help facilitate our tourist industry not bringing their cars into the city into queues of traffic and congestion. Hopefully, again, looking at electric vehicles to bring our visitors to the city, who are such a huge part of the city, our tourist industry, is to bring them in a clean way and making our streets safer and cleaner.
We need a radical response to the threat of extinction, and that requires a radical rethink of travel and transport too. Too much time has already been lost by prevaricating grey politicians. It is now the last roll of the dice, and there's no place for half measures and tired ideas like park and ride. In our first Green Council, we led the way with sustainable travel. The Lewis Road was transformed, increasing journeys by bus, bike and taxi. The Seven Dials was made safe for vulnerable road users, and the once severed community now thrives. 20 mile an hour profoundly calmed our streets, making them safer and more welcoming for everyone who wants to get around. We introduced the low emission zone, and we introduced the cycle share scheme and plans for transforming Valley Gardens. Not all these changes were welcomed at first, some unnecessarily frustrated too. These were bold changes that have won international recognition, and it requires us to be again bold if we're going to make our city a one planet city, living sustainably within our means. Residents want a healthy city, which is easy to get around, and Greens will create spaces for people, not cars. Enlarge clean air zones and cover cars and lorries too. Develop a local cycling and walking infrastructure plan with stakeholders involved from the outset, which draws on the best approaches. Basically, we'll go Dutch. Support investment in electric buses and other e-vehicles. Build on the achievement of 20 mile an hour through expansion, education and enforcement. And defend train services and support Brighton Mainline too. But we need to go further than this. We need to question why, for example, we have a dual carriageway on the top of our seafront, which could provide space for cycling and bus lanes. We need to embrace the opportunities of electric last mile delivery and e-bike sharing. We need a strategic cycle network for the whole of Greater Brighton. We need to look at developing a network of rapid bus hubs with integrated cycle parking and shared taxi drop-off. And we need one-stop apps for all travel.
What seems to be missing for Brighton Hove is a proper overarching transport strategy that looks way, way into the future. We don't appear, in my opinion, to be laying the foundation for how the transport is changing. We don't appear to be looking at what you and our citizens want and how transport modes can actually coexist. So the key message from me this evening on behalf of the Conservative Group is that we need a full and comprehensive integrated transport review and strategy that looks towards the next 30 years. Now, I would wish to see our citizens have the choice to walk, to cycle, to use public transport safely and affordably. And that's the phone that wasn't switched off. Get that right and the short car journeys disappear. We also need a transport system that enables those that have to drive, can, that businesses and homes can be serviced, that freight can move, that visitors can come, that enterprise and tourism is not stifled, and those that are just passing through can. So we need to consider also what we have done in our city. Assess the impact that schemes have had, what was good, what was bad, what could have improved, how we can learn from what we've done. Have the objectives of those schemes been achieved? And if we accept that transport is changing and needs to change, we need to accept that what was done before might already now, even in a short space of time, no longer be fit for purpose. And if a previous scheme isn't or hasn't been working, we should not contain our minds just to try and to bolt on a solution to change it, but we have to be prepared to start again.